هدي لنا لا إله إلا الله. إن الله وملائكته يصلون على النبي يا أيها الذين آمنوا صلوا عليه وسلموا تسليما.
اللهم صل على سيدنا
محمد. It affords us great pleasure and honor to have staged this occasion in honor of a distinguished son of this country, of this province, of this city. He needs no introduction, but the stages through which his evolution in the field of Dawah has taken place will be briefly outlined, if you will permit me. Way back in 1958, he, along with Ghulam Singh Banker and Mr. Khan, Mr. Muhammad Khan, Muhammad Ahmad Khan, the three musketeers, started very modestly, very quietly, the Islamic Propagation Center. People were not excited, were not unduly moved. They took it as perhaps an exercise in something, little knowing what was to become of this movement. Over the years, no fewer than 6,000 Muslims, new Muslims, newcomers to Islam, have accepted the deen through the Islamic Propagation Center. This is not a trifling number, and it is a tremendous achievement in every aspect of the world, particularly spiritually. And therefore, how can we, ordinary mortals, assess the value of this achievement? Many of you may wonder at this new appellation that he has acquired all of a sudden, Ustaz. People have asked me, what does this mean? I said, don't be disturbed. In Urdu it's called Ustad, wrongly. Of course the word is Ustaz, meaning, in the Middle East at any rate, a professor, a lecturer, a teacher, or an intellectual. It is an appellation of honor, a polite appellation of honor to somebody who is rated high as a man of letters, as a writer and so forth. So that's why it's called Ustaz. And it's an appellation which was conferred upon him by none other than the people who have conferred upon him this tremendous award, about $100,000, plus this gold medal which I will demonstrate to you. Those of you who wish to see it can only do so under the careful scrutiny of Mr. Ahmad Didat, because I don't want this to leave this state at this moment. It is its value, of course, is meaningless because we cannot, as I said, value his achievements. And the original certificate in Arabic, which was conferred upon him by the distinguished panel of the King Faisal Award. This is the Arabic original. You may come and view it later on after the end of this meeting. Now we come to another milestone in Ustaz Ahmad Didat's achievements, and that is a very great milestone. The founding of As-Salam, way out about 72 miles from here in the wilderness of the south coast, at a place called Bremer, or nearby Bremer, was a piece of land which was donated by the Kadwa family, and that land was overgrown with shrub. Sometimes there was sugar cane, but it was more or less a barren, hilly, undulating natal landscape. There, since 1959, he and his family dedicated themselves and spent the best part of their lives cultivating this seminary, this missionary institution, this college, if you like, for the training of da'is, for the training of students in the Islamic field, and they have achieved today a phenomenal campus whose value materially at least is about R1 million. They have a school there which produces every 2 years 15 to 20 young men and women who are trained in the Islamic field. And there is a school too of about 230 from class 1 to standard 6, which is a secular school. Some of them are Muslims, some of them are not. But these young people are in an environment, in a campus, where the Islamic spirit prevails. Mr. Taher Rasool, the secretary of the Arabic Study Circle, will now read messages and telegrams from all over the world.
Mr. MC, our honored guest, my elders, brothers and sisters in Islam, Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. If I had to read the scores of messages that I hear, probably take all afternoon. So what I will do is pick a few at random and go through them. The first message or indication that was received was a telegram sent to Brother Ibrahim Jadwat. It reads, Assalamu alaikum. Please convey our sincere congratulations to Brother Ahmad Didar, who has been awarded the King Faisal Award for his outstanding contributions to Islamic work. May Allah reward him. Wassalam, best regards. It was sent by M. Yaqub Mirza, Jamal Barzinji, Hisham Al Talib, Ahmad Tutunji, Abdul Hamid Abu Sulaiman. Then there was a telegram. It gives me great pleasure. It was addressed to Mr. Ahmad Didar, President of the Islamic Propagation Center. It gives me great pleasure to inform you that the selection committee of the King Faisal International Prize has chosen you as co-winner for the King Faisal International Prize for the Service of Islam this year. You will receive the award in an official ceremony under the patronage of His Majesty King Fahad ibn Abdul Aziz, Khalid Al Faisal bin Abdul Aziz, Chairman King Faisal International Prize Board. Then there was a telegram addressed to Brother Ahmad Didar. Please accept our heartiest congratulations for being awarded this year's King Faisal Award for services to Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept your services for His cause. Wassalam, Dr. Tawfiq Al-Qaisar, Secretary General, Wani, Islamia, Riyadh. Jazakallah.
Brothers and sisters, that was only a selection of the messages that we received. There are many more that we cannot go through. Now I have great pleasure in calling upon Ustaz Ahmad Didar to address you on this subject.
A'udhu billahi min ash-shaytan ar-rajim. Bismillahir Rahmanir Rahim. أحسن قولا ممن دعا إلى الله وعمل صالحا وقال إنني من المسلمين. صدق الله, صدق الله العظيم. Mr. Chairman and my dear brothers and sisters, it has been quite an embarrassing experience sitting here and with all the beautiful words and sentiments that have been expressed about me. But I know, as always, that there is, you know, all this is being used as a bait to say, now look, we want to also have something from you in return. And in return, what can I give you better than Allah's kalam? Where Allah bari ta'ala questions us rhetorically. He's questioning us. He said, وَمَنْ أَحْسَنُ قَوْلًا مِمَّنْ دَعَى إِلَى اللَّهِ. Who is better in speech than he who invites people to Allah's ways? وَعَمِلَ صَالِحًا, and he's a doer of good deeds. وَقَالَ إِنَّنِي مِنَ الْمُسْلِمِينَ, and he says, I'm of those who have submitted our wills to the will of Allah. In the question, the answer is reposed in the question. Allah bari ta'ala is saying that there is none better in speech than he who invites people to Allah's ways. This is a rhetorical question. He's not asking us for information. He's telling us that there is none better in speech, that the best type of talking, speech making, discussion, conversation, dialogue, debate, is this, that you invite people to the way of Allah and you are a good example yourself, do good deeds, you practice what you preach, and you are of the body of Islam, the Ummah of the Muslims. Everybody's agreed. How can we disagree? This is what Allah says. This is the best. Occupation, preoccupation, hobby, whatever you call it, the best Allah says is this. And unknowingly, I was trying to practice it. Unknowingly, that I was trying to fulfill this requirement of Allah bari ta'ala. We are all agreed that this is the best pastime or occupation for a Muslim, is to invite people to Allah's ways. But the question arises, where do we start? And this is where the subject of this afternoon's chat or talk that I have chosen is, that there is a Siddiq in your life. Find him. Where did I get this idea from? That there is a Siddiq in your life, means everyone's life. There ought to be a Siddiq. I have chosen this title from the close relationship between our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq, his bosom friend and companion. Even before Islam, before our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam was appointed to deliver his message, our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam and Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq were close friends even before Islam. But his name was not Abu Bakr Siddiq or Abu Bakr. His real name was Abdul Kaaba ibn Abu Quhafa. That was his name. Subsequently known as Abu Bakr Siddiq. Abdul Kaaba ibn Abu Quhafa, bosom friend with our Nabi. As soon as Allah bari ta'ala commanded our Nabi to proclaim his mission, the very first person he thought of was Abu Bakr, actually Abdul Kaaba ibn Abu Quhafa. And he made an investigation, both living in the same city. Where is Abdul Kaaba ibn Abu Quhafa? And he found out that he was gone on a trade journey. So he bided his time. When he got the information that Abu Bakr, Abdul Kaaba, he had returned, he makes a beeline for his house, going to meet his friend, bosom friend. As soon as Abdul Kaaba returns to his house, he gets the information that his friend Muhammad had made some pronouncements about Allah bari ta'ala selecting him, electing him as his messenger. So he makes a beeline for the house of his friend Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And subsequently they both meet in the street in the opposite direction. Each in the opposite direction. Our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam had been the foremost. From his biography we learn that he had been the foremost in wishing people salams. The ashabas tried again and again, hiding behind walls, behind shrubs, to beat him, and they never succeeded. He was the first, anytime, every time, the first to wish salams. So he said, "Assalamu alaikum, Ya Abdul Ka'ba." That was his name. So Abdul Ka'ba, this Abu Bakr, he responds, he says, "Wa alaikum salam, Ya Muhammad." So where are you going, O Muhammad? He said, "I'm coming to see you." "And where are you going, Abdul Ka'ba?" He said, "I'm coming to see you." So what is the news? So the Holy Prophet Muhammad, he says, that the revelation of God has come to me, that there is but one Allah, and I'm his messenger. The immediate response, unquestionable response was, "I accept." Say the Shahada, so he said the Shahada. "Ashhadu an la ilaha illallah wa ashhadu anna Muhammad Rasulullah." This is the type of confidence, faith, trust that he had in our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, which made him to get this subsequent title, As-Siddiq, the verifier of truth, the truthful, As-Siddiq. So I say that there must be a Siddiq in our life as well. There must be somebody along the line who trusts you so much, who has such confidence in you, that whatever you say, the person is prepared to accept. Is there such a person in your life? I came across such a person in my life. And I'm giving an example to give you an idea of what I actually mean. I worked in the furniture trade for the longest part of my life besides this. Now in the propagation field, the years outnumber that of the furniture trade. But about 10 to 12 years I worked in the furniture trade, ending off with the simplex furniture, before I started the propagation work, with the simplex furniture factory, furniture firm here in Alice Street, Durban. And after about a year of wandering around, lecturing in Natal, Transvaal, Cape, one day I returned to the furniture concern, meeting my old friends. And they all wanted to know, gather around me, the other salesmen with whom I was working, they wanted to know my experiences. "So what are you doing? What's your achievement?" And I started telling them. So, you know, I went to the Cape and I delivered a big lecture there and I did this and I did that. And they were all very, very happy to listen to me, telling them about what I was achieving in a little way compared to what we are doing now. Very little, but they were very, very impressed. As soon as I finished that conversation and I'm looking back, and I find an African gentleman, he was also listening in. This African gentleman, his name was Tatan Pengu Zulu. See, I had started with this furniture firm at the end of 1939 or the beginning of 40. And I started off as a van driver, driving a van, 1.5 ton van, delivering furniture. And Tatan was with me on the van. Then I got promotion to driving a 3-ton truck. And Tatan Pengu was with me on the truck. And this Tatan Pengu had a fantastic character. Wonderful man. He was so obedient, so faithful. Whatever you give him to do, perfect. He perfectly does it. And always at the double. You know, he doesn't drag his feet like most people do. Anything at the double. Anything you tell him, say, "Yako-san, Yako-san." Whatever you say, "Kosan" is like the son of a chief. You know, the driver. He treats you so nicely. You know? A person, you know, you feel happy to work with him. Then I got promoted into the shop. I become a dispatch clerk. So he gets promoted into the showroom, arranging furniture. and it carried on. Now I left the job and doing propagation work, and I found him listening intently at what I was saying. So when I look at him, I says, Tatan, you know I'm delivering the message of Islam all over the country, but I haven't delivered it to you yet. He said, Yakosa, that is true. I says, you know, I must deliver this message to you as well. He says, Yakosa, it should be. I said, and your family as well. He says, Yakosa. Whatever I say, he says, Yakosa. He agrees. Whatever I'm telling him, he is agreeing. So I said, look, Saturday afternoon, 1 o'clock, I'll pick you up from the furniture shop. You finish at 1, ask your wife and your children to be also there. I'll pick you all up and I'll take you home to Verulam. I lived in Verulam. At that time, I still live in Verulam now. I said, I'll take you to Verulam and I'll have lunch together and you spend the weekend with me. He said, Lungilo Kosa. So, according to this appointment, Saturday afternoon, 1 o'clock, after 1, I go there to the corner of Simplex Furniture Factory and Alice Street and Gray Street corner, and he's waiting there with his wife and 2 sons. So I get into the car, I take them home, we have lunch together, we sit down for a little while, and then I said, look, Tatan, let us take a walk to the river. There is the Mshoti River, just close by where I was living. So we take a walk down to the river and sit on the river bank. So I'm telling him everything about Islam, you know, the teachings of Islam. Whatever I tell him, he says he agrees. He agrees. He agrees. Anything, everything, he agrees. So I tell him, he says, Tatan, you agree with everything? He says, yes. I said, why don't you become a Muslim? He says, Lungele Kosa. I said, what about your wife and children? They too. He says, yes, Kosa. So I said, look, I'm conducting classes in the Pine Street Madrasa Hall. At that time, every Sunday I was conducting classes, what we call Bible classes, actually teaching the young men how to use the Bible in propagating the faith. So I said, you come over next Sunday with your wife and children, you know, have a nice ghusl, as the Muslims ought to have, I explain every details, come to the hall and I will have you converted. Following Sunday, he was there with his wife and 2 sons. So he accepted Islam. I named his, one was Rashid and one was Yusuf, and they went to the Pine Street Madrasa. As Rashid did that and Yusuf did that. This young man who is also shooting is, yes, Yusuf did that, he is my son, but the other young man, also a son of mine, he had reverted to Islam. Rashid and Yusuf were at the Pine Street Madrasa hall. So I said, there is this type of a person in our life. The person who has such faith and confidence in you, that if you tell him during noonday, 12 o'clock in the afternoon, you tell him that, look, this is evening, this is night, and the fellow can say, yes, I accept, I agree. I know, not that, not so bad, but people must have some faith and confidence in us. If we haven't got it, in our life, we have no such person, no Muslim, who has such faith in us, then there is something wrong with us. That in society, we move around, we have dealings, social communication, and there is not a man among the non-Muslims who can look up to you with respect, with the feeling that this man will never mislead me. The type of a person who is the type of Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq. When our Nabi Kareem sallallahu alaihi wasallam, when he returned from Mi'raj, the people were making a mockery, Abu Jahl and the like. What are you talking about? As soon as this news reached Abdul Kaaba ibn Abu Quhafa, he says, if my prophet says so, I believe so. That he had an ascension, he went into the mysteries that Allah Bari Ta'ala showed him in his own presence. If Muhammad says so, it must be so. So the message is that there is a Siddiq in your life. Look for him. Find him and embrace him. وآخر الدعوان أن الحمد لله رب العالمين.
That I admire for that. By God, I admire her. She's Muslim. She's Muslim-like. Maybe she's reading the Quran. Because Allah tells us in the Quran, evil should not be noise abroad, broadcast, except where injustice has been done. Because once you say things, there are things you can insinuate and you can program people. Like this. Look how easily people can be programmed. British girls are too easy. There are fools who are paying £15 for 547 pages. This satanic Salman's satanic verses, 547 pages, thick, these are thick pages, cheap paper. They are out to mint money. The cover is beautiful. The cover, as you see, is very beautiful.